Hey everyone! Today I'm going to be walking you through the process of creating a part that can follow another part. Similar to like how a homing missile would work. It's going to follow the player until it either hits them or there's a time limit or whatever. Today I'm just going to walk you through the process of the following mechanic. And this was actually suggested by one of my subscribers, so I thank you for that. And I actually spent a lot of time trying to figure this out. So in order to start, I'm going to create two parts really quick. I'm going to create one part and then a second part. And the part on the left, I'm going to rename to follower. And the part on the right, I'm going to rename to followed. And I'm also going to color code these really quick. So I'm going to set the follower part to red, just so it's easier to see what's happening once we actually have our code running, and our follow to green. All right. So now on our follower part, I'm going to add a script. And then inside of that script, I first need to start making my variables that I'm going to need. And our first variable is going to be the part that the script is attached to. So the follower part we need to get in this code. And we just need to grab a reference of that by grabbing the parent of the script. And then we need to set the goal part or the follower part or the followed part, I should say. The part that this part that the follower is going to be chasing, basically. And I'm just going to call that goal. I'm going to call the variable for that goal equals. And for right now, I'm just going to hard code in the name of the part. So I'm going to put game.workspace.followed. And then we need to set a velocity for the moving object. And for right now, I am going to just set it for 20. So I'm going to put local velocity equals 20. So it's basically going to move 20 units per second. And now, we also need to set one more variable, and that's the stop distance equals 2.5. I like to set it for. This is an optional part. I like to add it just so if the part is close enough, it won't just keep running into the part if it's reached it. You can also do this another way if you want to set, like, if it touches the part. But right now, we're just going to set a stop distance for it. And now we need to create the actual function. So, our function is going to be, we're going to call it move. So, local function move. And a parameter we need for the move function is step. We'll just put step on the inside. Now, before we start actually creating our function, start to actually putting code inside our function, let's write one thing on the bottom of our script really quick. And this is going to be game colon get service run service. And the run service allows different functions so you can call different things at different parts of the runtime. And we're going to use the step function, which essentially, in a basic sense, is the moment at the beginning of every frame. So every time a frame is rendered in Roblox, stepped is going to be the first thing that's called. And we need to colon connect a function to that. And this is where it gets a little weird. We're going to put a function inside a function. So we're going to do function time, which is the current time, the actual real life time when of that frame. And then we need step, which as we put in the parameters for move before. And then inside of this, we're going to do move step. And what step is the time between each frame, or time between the current frame and the last frame. So then the time between rendering, which is essential in order to calculate how far we're going to move the object during this frame. Now, let's actually start defining our function. And then the first part is to define a variable inside And this is going to be our distance between the part and the goal part. In order to do this, first let's put some parentheses, and then we're going to do part dot position minus goal dot position. Outside of the parentheses now, we'll do dot magnitude. All right, so a little explanation of this is the position returns a vector 3, and we're going to be tracking them together and then getting the magnitude, which returns a float value, which is the actual distance between the two parts. So now we have to do an if statement to check if our part is within the stop, is greater than the stop distance. Because if it's less than the stop distance, we don't want to move it, basically. Is greater, oh, not stop distance. We want if distance is greater than stop distance. Then, and then inside this if statement, we're going to write our code that is actually going to move our object forward. And this is going to be done with one line. And in order to start it, we're going to get the C frame of our part. So part.C frame. And we're going to have this equal to part.C frame again. However, we're going to do colon lerp. And then we are going inside this, we are going to put goal.C frame. And what the lerp function does is it'll move the from the current part, it'll move a certain amount, it'll move the C frame a certain amount from the current part's position, the part.C frame, to the goal.C frame. So the lerp function takes two arguments. The goal, which is what we called our part that we're going to. And then it takes a value from 0 to 1, basically 0% to 100%. If it's 0, it's not going to move at all. If it's 50%, it's going to move halfway to the goal. And if it's 100%, it's going to move all the way to the goal. And now, we have to do a little math function in order to calculate how much we should move it for each frame. So in order to do that, first we need to get our step, which is the time between the current frame and the last frame. And then we need to multiply that by velocity divided by distance. And so the velocity divided by distance is calculating how much time is needed to get to the part from the current position. And then we're multiplying it by the step to get the actual real distance that we need to move it. And this would create a basic moving object. So I'm going to head back to my classic base plate and I'm going to click on run. And as we can see, it is now heading towards our object. There we go. But now, as you can see, we have a little problem here. It is not rotating. If I want it to be like a homing missile, I want it just the front to keep looking at the part, right? So now, let's go into our code and add the line that'll make it so our part will look at the item it's chasing. All right, now, in order to make our follower part look at our goal part, we'll need to add another line that translates the rotation. So we'll have to make it look at that part. And Roblox has a simple function that's built in to do this. We're going to do part dot C frame equals C frame dot new. And the C frame dot new function takes two arguments. The first one is the C frame you want it to be. So it can either be a set of numbers or it can be a C frame from another part. So we're going to use the part.c frame since we want this to be in the same position, but then it can also take a second property, which is what you want it to look at. And we want it to look at the goal.c frame. Actually, these need to be dot position since c frame.new takes a vector 3, not a c frame. But it's going to result in a C frame. And now, let's run this and see what happens. Let's click run. And as you can see, our part is now chasing and it's going to keep looking at it. So now we have a little follower, and he's always going to look at the followed part. Easy enough. So now, I don't want that to be the front angle, right? I want it to be the skinnier side. I don't want it to be this long, the long side of the part. So I'm going to hit stop. And this is what you're going to need to do if you use like a custom model or anything like that in order to actually rotate the part to the correct front that you want to use for it, basically. So we're going to multiply it by C-frame dot angles, and then we're going to put math.rad parentheses 0, math.rad again, parentheses 0, and then, as we've done two other times, math.rad, parentheses 0. So, and now I want it to rotate along the y-axis, so just the top part rotates. And in order to do that, I just want it to rotate 90 degrees, right? Because I don't want the long side, I want the short side, so I have to turn it 90 degrees. So I'll rotate at 90, and the math.rad part is there to convert degrees into radians, which, if you don't know what those are, it's another way to determine angles using pi. And I know how to read that, but it's easier just to type in degrees and have Roblox convert them for you. So, I want to rotate it 90 degrees. So now, when I press run, my skinny side is pointing towards our part. So let me hit select, and as you can see, my skinny part is heading towards our part. So now I want to show you something. As you've seen, our follower part's been chasing around our follow part like a snake on the ground, basically. But if I want it to be like a homing missile, I want it to be able to float in the air. So let's see what happens if we try to make it float. Oh, it is now jumping like a person or like an animal it's like trying to reach that block, but it just can't reach that block, which is kind of funny. It's kind of funny to look at that way. And it's really hopping around. It's really trying. It is really trying to get to this part. But I just want this to be a homing missile. So in order to make it basically turn off gravity for this part, so gravity is ignored by it, let's hit stop. And now we'll have to actually add something to the follower part. And that's what's called a body mover. So we're going to look at body force, not a body mover, it's a body force. And now, let's go into our script, and let's set what our body force should be. So, it's on our part, which is our follower, part.bodyForce equals vector 3, it takes in a vector 3, dot new, parentheses, 0, comma, part, colon, mass, so getting the actual mass of the part, times workspace dot gravity, comma, 0. So basically what this is doing is it is just canceling out gravity by pushing it the same amount that gravity's pushing down. And that's all that line's basically doing. Oh, before we actually test that, I realized I had one small error. So I was right in grabbing the body force, but we actually need to set the force on the body force entity, basically. So we have to just add dot force to that. And now, if I go back and click run, it will work. There we go. And let me grab my move tool. And if I click on the part and move it up, it is now being chased. But as you see, my follower part is still following gravity. But if I move it over here and then move it up, have it go down, it is chasing it just like a homing missile would. So now, there's one last part I just want to show you. Just a little note. If you want to set like a custom changing followed part, basically, what you're going to want to do is add a value to our a value object to our script, and we want it to be a object value. And for right now, I'm going to set this to our followed part. And then in our script, I want to change the goal to be part dot, change it to script dot value. Dot value. Because the object is named value, but we need the value data object inside of it. And you're also going to want to move the goal line. Let me copy this. Inside our move function. Because if you leave it up top, it's only going to update when the game starts. But if you put it on the inside, it's going to update during every frame. So then if it changes during gameplay, it'll switch to the other part then. So let me head back to my classic base plate. And I'll press run. And as you can see, it's following my green part right now, since that's what I had the value set to. But now let me spawn in another part. And let me go into my follower, into my script, into my value, and let me change the value to this new part. As you can see, it changes course and is now heading towards that part. And I can change it back to followed, and it just flips right around. I can keep having it bounce back and forth. And there we go. So, that is how to create a part that follows another part in Roblox. There was some complicated math in that, but it shouldn't have been too much. And if you have any questions, leave them down below. I hope you found this useful. I put a lot of work into actually designing all this code, basically, and figuring out how to actually move it live during gameplay without causing a lot of performance issues. Because I originally started to test it using wait functions, which caused a lot of performance issues because it was waiting all the time. But this was a very efficient way of doing it. Please like and subscribe if you enjoyed this, if you learned anything, and leave any tutorial suggestions down below. I got this one from a subscriber, so if you have an idea, leave it down below, and I'd love to look into it. I had a lot of fun looking into this. So, until next time. I'll see you guys later. Bye.